First, it's time to start our meeting. Please invite the officials to join us.
I'd
like to welcome the officials from the Constitutional Mainland Affairs, the Department of Justice, and the Hong Kong Police Force. This is the 12th meeting of the Bills Committee. We will continue with the scrutiny of clauses 7 and 8. Four members pressed the button to raise questions last time, but they didn't have time to do it. So I will invite them to speak now in the same order. None of them is here. What about other members? Mr. Jeremy Tam, 4 minutes. Chairman, are we on cross seven? Can I confirm this first? We are on both cross seven and cross eight. So my question about cross seven is that is there some overlapping in the seven bracket one and seven bracket two? One says a person blah 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 intend to insult the national anthem. The second sub crosses if the person intentionally insults the national anthem in any way. So my point is, shouldn't we combine both bracket 1 and bracket 2? There's no need to have two sub-crosses. So when we talk about the meaning of insult and whether we should stand solemnly, and we ask whether it would be okay if someone is sitting on a wheelchair, and he said it's okay. And now you have an API in which the old woman has to stand up when the national anthem in that API. We're on cross seven, and you rather be asking questions on cross four. No, that you said it was okay in our meeting, and then very soon you published this API. I want to clarify the second question. The API is not a government API. As for the first question, I'll ask Mr. Pang to respond. We have made reference to the Article 15 of the National Law on National Anthem. And that is in respect of author lyrics and author scores or sung in a distorted or respective way. The wording can be found in Article 15. The 7 bracket 2 wording is similar to that in Article 15. Because in accordance with the interpretation rule and also the context, if we combine the two, we may not be able to cover any other way not covered by 7 bracket 1. So this is to reflect the legislative intent of the national law. I'm still confused. I know you are doing things to reflect the national law and to apply the national law locally. 7 bracket 2 says it's in any way, if you insult the national anthem in any way, then there's no need to have 7.1. 7.2 covers everything. And then that is related to the question of score. You know, you copy the wording of the national law, and then you copy it, and then you also have 7.2. Well, why can't you just have one subclause? Why can't you combine the two subclauses, Mr. Pan? We'd like to reflect as far as possible the legislative intent of the national law. But two is already good enough. Chairman, in Article 15 of the national law, they talk about distorting the score or other ways in distorting the national anthem. So this is reflected in paragraph 1, and we believe this is an appropriate approach. Mr. Kenneth Leung, I have a question about 7, paragraph 3, paragraph 4, and paragraph 5, and the difference of these sub-crosses. Paragraph 5,
3 or 4, a person does not commit an offence under this section by publishing A, B, and C. 咁嘅意思
Why do you need to subcross 5? Is it because there are other circumstances that that are on social media or platform someone share distorted national anthem unintentionally? Let's see, I find a video clip very interesting, I share with someone. Would it be covered by or regulated by 7.7? Is my interpretation correct? Permanent Secretary, Mr. Leung's understanding is right. 7.4, 7.5 are all about publication. And 7.5 says that if you will not be covered by 7.3 and 7.4 if you don't have an intention. If you share something in Instagram or through the Twitter and some social media, under the common law, when you press a charge, what factors would you look to ascertain that there's no intention in sharing that message? Because with one click, I can share the clip with hundreds of people. What factors will be taken into account? What factors will be looked at? I think it's the reverse of the situation. This is criminal law. The prosecution has to prove that under Breaker 3 and Breaker 4, there's an intention before there's an offense. The accused will not have to prove his innocence. We will simply communicate or share a video clip with someone else without writing anything accompanying the sharing. Would that mean that it's not sufficient to commit an offense? We have to look at the facts. If we don't have anything to prove the intention, we cannot really press the charge. We cannot prosecute. So how can you gather the evidence on the internet and people using social media? We just share a video clip. The original distributor might already have been prosecuted, but his friends might not know a lot about the situation. And with just a click, the video clip can be shared. And this is done by many social media user, and they would add a remark that this is just for sharing, and I don't have any comment. So they would say that they just share this without any comment. How do you assess such a case? It's difficult to comment on individual cases like this. But if what Mr. Leung has said is represent the full facts, then we cannot prove that an offence has been committed without the intention. Dr. K.K. Kwok, there's a Hong Kong All China Youth Federation, which has produced an API, which according to the government, does not represent the views of the government. And then that old woman on a wheelchair suddenly become very active and had to stands up when the national anthem is played. You have to criticize them because this will affect the health of elderly people like the old woman. This is not very humane. It's not even a good taste in an attempt to show that these people are patriotic. Would you censure these people publicly? In answering the question from another member, I clarify that API to publicize the national anthem is not produced by the government. So that's a matter of fact that I would like to clarify. If someone in the community that promotes or produces APIs or any promotional material to publicize the need to respect the national anthem, we welcome that. And in that clip, yes, it shows the respect paid by the old woman. And that old woman stands up because she can, just to show her respect. And I respect the portrayal. As I've said, if someone is on a wheelchair and cannot stand up physically speaking, then it's not a problem when the national anthem is played and it does not stand up. So we'll look at the objective facts of each case. The message in that particular video is clear. So you are not going to criticize the producer of that clip. So that's dangerous because old women will have to stand up. Well, she was a veteran of the East River Column back in the era of anti-Japanese war. But that's not relevant. I don't want to waste time on such meaningless clarification. Please return to this cross 7. I'm afraid what the secretary has said would not lead to any improvement. Rather, people would ask the disabled to stand up, and even for those who are dumb, would have to pretend that they can sing. It's related to 7.1. We're talking about publicly and intentionally. Well, he thinks that that particular API represents the standard. I asked him to clarify whether it's the government standard, and he has refused to do this. So you are saying that even those who cannot move or who cannot stand up will have to stand up, or even disabled people will have to stand up to show the respect. I don't think this is related to 7.1. You may choose to reply or not. I agree with you that this is not related to 7.1, but anyway, we would like to venture a response. Well, the comment that the member has said is not in line with the fact, and it's very irresponsible. Well, I ask you for clarification. Who is irresponsible? I just want to prevent old people from being pressed into doing something. Like that, Mr. Gary Fang. I have a question about 7.2. A person, if the person publicly and intentionally insults the national anthem in any way, he commits an offense. I'm afraid that in a trial, how you can interpret this reference to in any way Is there a possibility or risk of regarding this as a catch-all requirement? Is that Article 15 of the national law that in a public place, an open public forum, if someone plays or sing the national anthem in a distorted or respectful or in any other way, is that it can might be interpreted narrowly? That's why it's now been reflected in two subclauses in the bill to avoid the narrow interpretation instead of strictly adhering to the wording of the national law. I think this is going to be interpreted because on the other hand, on the other side of the spectrum to the narrow interpretation is the widest possible interpretation. The day after tomorrow will mark the centenary of the May 4th movement. And now SAR government is trying to reinterpret the national law and national anthem and then subdivide Article 15 of the basic law into two subclauses in the bill. Look at how Xi Jinping has interpreted the May 4th movement. He talks about patriotism without mentioning anything about science and democracy. That's the behavior of the Central People's Government. And now the government is trying not to copy strictly the wording in the national law, but try to divide this into two. Because to ordinary people, in Hong Kong, this would cause fear. It seems that in any way, that is not just distortion or the altering scores or the lyric might lead to the commission of an offense. The scope will be very, very big indeed. Have you tried to expand the national law on national anthems in the local legislation? I've already answered this. Why haven't you followed strictly the wording in the national law? Well, I think they have to confirm that the scope has been widened before they can answer the question about whether the wording should be strictly followed. Mr. Pang, we use the word in another way. Because under the interpretation rule, any other way would be interpreted in such a way that it would be similar to 7.1a. So that any other way would not be interpreted like the national law. Mr. Ted Hui? Please ring the bell.
李鋒議員4分鐘。
Mr. Chung, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. The offences under Clause 7. Of course, we understand that there must be a criminal act and the intent before there is an offence. Under Section 7.1 is very clear, a person commits an offence if he actually, for example, alters the lyrics or unplays the anthem in a distorted manner, and that it would have to be intentional and that there is an intent to insult. But 7.2 is not very clear. I think the requirement is that there should be, the person should publicly, intentionally insult the national anthem, but you say in any way. So this is very dangerous and also very confusing for the public. That is, in the national anthem law, there are certain behavior alluded to, and we don't know what you are referring to. And many members already asked the question regarding possible scenarios and whether or not they would constitute an offence. And you say that it would depend on whether or not it's done in a public place, whether it's intentional, whether it's an insult. Now, let's say if somebody deliberately and openly, you know, insult the national anthem law, he calls a press conference and say that he's conducting this act because he wants to insult the national anthem. He say it sets online on the internet that he wants to insult the national anthem. But what he has done is that in a sports event, he doesn't stand up when the national anthem is being performed. He deliberately, you know, goes away and go to the toilet. Would that case, would he be caught under 7.1? Please. You like explain, Chairman. According to this scenario, regarding all the behavior, you know, referred to by Mr. Hui, namely the person who publicly said that he has the intention to insult the national anthem, if the law enforcement discovered that there's any way which under the law would constitute an insult, then it would be he would have committed an offence. Now, say if I deliberately don't stand up, I don't sing the national anthem and goes away to the toilet, apparently the law enforcement will take action. Mr. Hui, please do not, you know, engage in a dialogue with the official. According to what, which rule, that we're not allowed to be engaged in a dialogue? Because you've been making the mistake, you know, over and over again. I think in the rules of procedure, could the clerk, let's you know, hold the clock, stop the clock for a moment, and ask the clerk to explain. Legal advisor. I think the procedure for members to ask to speak is for the member to first of all seek the permission of the chairman, and then the bureau can answer the question. Could you please speak, you know, when I ask you to? Why are you interrupting me like this manner? Thank you, Chairman. Regarding the hypothetical scenario described by Mr. Hui, that if somebody has openly stated that he has the intention to insult the national anthem and also commit an act which would constitute an insult according to the law, then in that scenario, we would need to take enforcement action. I described certain, you know, behaved acts, and you said that if such acts are committed under the law, but they're not provided for under Section 7.2. Isn't that too vague? If I publicly said I want to insult the national anthem, and when the national anthem is being played, I just scratch my head or touch my face, is there no objective way for the law enforcement to interpret or decide whether or not it's an offence? So long as I publicly state that I want to insult the national anthem, then any act would be construed to be an insult. I think when the Bills Committee first met, we already issued a paper to respond to questions by your legal advisor, the CB 2893. In that paper, we deliberately quoted SAI versus Ng Kung Siu case. When somebody involving a... Now, in that sense, if we want to safeguard the dignity of the national the national flag, we must, you know, make all efforts to protect the national flag in order that it will not be insulted. As to the phrase in any way, like Mr. Pang said, this is actually compatible with the spirit of the national anthem law. And, you know, prescribing behavior in this manner that more than 200, enactments in Hong Kong, which actually also, make use of that manner of description. Are you saying that we need to respect the national anthem? So if somebody publicly said something, then any act would be construed to be, would be regarded as an offense. Mr. Uchiwai. Thank you. Using the example I gave last week, let's say somebody plays something onto YouTube, like I said last time. This person is watching a clip on the YouTube, although the content of that clip is actually disrespectful or undermining the dignity of the national anthem, but there is no intention, and therefore there is no such thing as, so there's no offense involved. You just watch it on the internet. Applying the same conduct, or concept rather, if a bystander thinks that such behavior on his part is actually undermining the dignity of the national anthem and reports that to the authorities, then the police will need to gather evidence to judge whether or not such an act is an intention to actually undermine the dignity of the national anthem. If somebody doesn't know whether that person has the intention, but he thinks that he is not respecting the national anthem, he will report to police. The police will take action. I'd like to know whether or not that would be, that would actually happen. Now, if somebody were to report to the police, of course the police would need to follow up. But the act as to how that act is to be followed upon will depend on the facts of the case. So in other words, so the customer in the restaurant may be invited by the police to assist with the investigation if there's a report, and then the police will decide whether there's evidence to show that he has that intention. If he has the intention, he would have broken the law, otherwise there is no offense. So the police will need to actually review his intention. If somebody reports to the police as to how the police deal with the case, whether the person would need to be taken to the police station, that would depend on the circumstances at the time, and I'm sure the police will make a professional judgment. I'm sure, given the way the bill was drafted, I think we should know how the police would act in such a scenario. He said it would depend on the circumstances of the case. I already described the scenario. A customer in a restaurant is playing something on YouTube. The content of that, may be disrespectful. I've already answered the question as to how that situation will be handled. So the police will enforce the law in an arbitrary manner? No, it's not. I think Mr. Wu said that if somebody were to report to the police, whether or not the police would take the person to the police station for investigation. I said that if there's a report, the police will follow up. As to how the police follow up on that will depend on the facts of the case and the professional judgment of the police. So it will be for the police to decide whether or not to entertain the complaint based on their professional judgment. Ray Chen. Now, I'd like to ask my question regarding enforcement. If that person were to play or sing the national anthem in a distorted manner, that would be an insult. When you take enforcement action, you need to put a stop to that act or arrest the person immediately. But in terms of publication, somebody, makes a recording and then, put it onto the internet. Does the law enforcement include, the immediate removal of what has been published on the internet? So, and who is to be responsible for that removal? If the government said that if the video is just being shared, there is no intention to insult, there's no offense. I asked my question regarding the internet. Does it mean that the the operator of the internet should remove it if they can. You talk about, you know, things going viral on the internet. If something were being it were not removed, it would go viral worldwide. Now, the law enforcement authorities, will they try to stop that as well? Regarding publication on the internet and how the law is enforced, the police commissioner, Mr. Chen, can answer the question. If the police receives any report of a suspended criminal act, if it is proven that somebody is disseminating things on the internet, which is we suspect to be insulting the national anthem, we will immediately, contact the internet, supplier. So this approach is consistent with the way we deal with, dissemination of improper materials on the internet. So we inform the operator, the person responsible for the internet or the work. So it's the supplier. Well, there are many suppliers on the internet. You can have the broadband supplier and also the person in charge of the individual websites. So do they all have such a responsibility? Mr. Chan, if we discover that there is a suspected, committing of an offense, if we find any illegal materials on the internet, we'll ask the service supplier to remove such materials. At the personal level, you say that would need to be an intention to insult the national anthem. I think that's difficult proof. So if somebody has shared such a clip, then does it mean that the person has to explain to you what his intention is? I think intent is, under the law, there is a way to prove whether or not somebody has an intention. For an offence to have been committed, it would depend on whether or not there is an intent. And the law enforcement authorities will have to provide the evidence. You cannot arbitrarily, say that somebody is guilty. Now, sometimes we find something interesting or funny or obscene or whatever on the internet, could you go wait for the next round? Your time is up. Jeremy Tam. Thank you. I'd like to ask a question regarding clause 7, bracket 7. It's on the following page, actually. Under subsection 7, we have A and B, 7A and B. This is in respect of when proceedings may be commenced. Let's say if I publish something which is tantamount to an insult to the national anthem law on the internet. The moment of publication might have been, 3 or 4 years ago, and you can still see what I've published on the internet now. I published it some time ago, but the material still can still be found on the internet. Then, regarding clause 7, let's say this is something which took place 4 or 5 years, then you cannot hold the person accountable even though the material can still be viewed on the internet. Or is it that since the material is still on the internet, the person would be considered to have, committed the offence? I think, as in the case of local legislation, there is no retrospective effect. To decide whether or not somebody is guilty of publishing such a material, I think we would consider the moment at the time when he, published such materials. 7 bracket 5 already provide for an exemption. I understand now. So would that be a loophole if somebody deliberately insults the national anthem? Just because the bill has not come into effect now, I will try to, you know, distort the national anthem in different social media networks, and I will not actually, you know, remove them. And once the bill becomes law, you cannot prosecute, because when I committed this act, the bill has yet to become the law. And subsequently, under Section 5, you say that for the person who simply share, you know, what I posted 4 or 5 years ago, anyway, what I uploaded, you know, before the law came into effect. Would this be a loophole in that case?
Secretary. Or permanent secretary. Well, for the first one that publishes the material, if after that he didn't update the publication, then the first person who published the material will not be brought to prosecution. But for the other people who share the clip, then he may be held responsible because he has the intent. Mr. Alvin Young, I would like to follow up on Mr. Jeremy Tam's question. I would like to ascertain the following points as to whether my understanding is correct. So there's no retrospective effect. Before the enactment of this piece of legislation, for anyone who publishes such materials, then the person who publishes it will not be held liable. But if the material is put on the internet, and if people think that it has an intent to insult the national anthem, and it's still on the internet, what would happen? Now, if the police ask the service provider to remove that material first? According to Mr. Chen, yes, that will happen. If anyone after the enactment shares materials with the intent to insult the national anthem, then the materials will be removed. So for this questionable material, if it has not been studied by the courts yet, but the police spot it online, how can the police be sure that this controversial material has the intent to insult the national anthem? Will it bring the case to the court first? Well, I used to work for the Customs and Excise Department. I can share some experience with you. Now, the Customs and Excise Department would patrol the web 24 hours a day. And if we find anything wrong, or there's any piracy act, we would take action immediately. We would not wait for the court's decision. Well, according to the logic of the permanent secretary, then for the first one that published it, well, he did it before the enactment of the law, right? So he should not be held responsible, and only the internet service provider would have to answer to the police, right? Yes, Mr. Young is correct. Now, if the service provider is not in Hong Kong, but overseas, what will the police do? Chief Superintendent Mr. Chen, so overseas service provider or local service provider, if we find that there are any illegal materials on the internet, we will ask the materials to be removed. But of course, if it's an overseas provider, then we will have to rely on mutual assistance, and then we will ask the local authorities to contact that provider. So if the overseas provider refuses, and if we do not have mutual assistance arranged, then what would happen? Well, for most of the internet service providers, they would have a set of protocol against illegal acts. Mr. Charles Mock. Well, Mr. Yang has already asked some questions that I wanted to ask. Now, if some materials are to be removed and if they are on the platform of overseas service providers, then what would happen? Now, some of these providers may not even have offices in Hong Kong. You say that you will talk to the law enforcement authorities of that country seeking their help. Now, if they do not have similar laws in that country, will they help you? Is there a need for them to help you? Now, if they do not have the national anthem law and they don't have similar laws, will they help us to remove the materials? Yeah, you can ask, will they help? As I said just now, every overseas internet service providers would have their protocols against illegal behaviors, for example, violence behaviors or hate speeches. They would regulate such materials on their website. Now, first, we can contact the service providers and we can ask them to remove the materials according to their own protocol, or through our mutual legal assistance arrangement, we can ask the law enforcement to help us. Yes, I understand your answer. So first of all, if they have a protocol, then most big companies would have this kind of protocol. I think some small companies may not have that. So even though they have a protocol, do they really need to do this? Is it necessary for them to do this? We do not know. And if they do not cooperate, then we would have to rely on the mutual legal assistance. Is there a possibility that some countries may not help us to do this? Would this happen, Mr. Chen? Yes, there are all sorts of possibilities. This is a hypothetical case, so I cannot tell you for sure. This is what I mean. Some countries may not have similar laws. So you are saying that you cannot assure that this won't happen, right? Mr. Lok Chung Hong, just now Mr. Alvin Yang was very concerned about the possible loopholes. Now, if the suppliers are not willing to remove the relevant materials, what would happen? And Mr. Jeremy Tam asked, if some old clips remain on the internet, we cannot do anything about this. Well, I feel happy that they asked such questions. It seems that these members support the spirit of the National Anthem Bill. I'm not sure if they really think so, but there is a loophole, Chairman. Supposedly, well, we have a lot of hypothetical scenarios today. Now, if there's a person, he has a small server at home, and then he uses an anonymous IP and he uploads a clip onto his own small server at home, and this clip has an intent to insult the national anthem, and you cannot know who's publishing it because it's an anonymous IP. Maybe he's using a government computer in public libraries, and the government discovers this and it tries to look for the owner of the server and ask him to remove the clip, but he refuses to do so. Then how do you enforce the law? This may be another loophole. Who's going to answer this question? Mr. Chen? the nature of each case is different. Now we will have to look at the actual situation of the case, and we need to look at the evidence that we collect. We will have to look at circumstantial evidences before we can make any decision. So at this moment, I cannot tell you what kind of action we will take. I would like to know one thing. Well, if he's not uploading onto his own servers, if there are some private servers and the server owners are not willing to comply with the police suggestions or advice, so would they be regarded as helping to publish the materials? Would they be regarded as the person that publishes such materials? Mr. Chen? Now, for an internet service provider, as to whether he's breached the National Anthem Ordinance, there are three major elements. Now, is this a public act? Is it intentional? Does he have the intent to insult the National Anthem? And has he committed an offense under the ordinance? If all these elements are proven to be involved, then I think he has committed the offense. Mr. KK Kwok, I would also like to ask a question about 7.1a, that is, alters the lyrics or score of the national anthem. Now, for the national anthem, is actually a song from a Chinese movie, Children of Troubled Times. We can change it like, arise, we who refuse to be slaves of the Communist Party. So what if he changed it like this? Now, the peoples of China are at the most critical time because there's no democracy at all. This are descriptions of facts. If in a piece of work, a person has written these two sentences, that is, we who refuse to be slaves of the Communist Party, the peoples of China are at their most critical time because there's no democracy and freedom. Everybody must roar defiance. So this is stating the fact. So will this be regarded as disrespecting the national anthem, and he's not singing out these phrases? Chairman, I won't comment on what Dr. KK Kwok says. Well, for your hypothetical scenario, first of all, we have to go back to Clause 8, that is, whether those phrases closely resembles the national anthem and lead to the reasonable belief that it is the national anthem, and whether it has an intent to insult the national anthem. So did you think that I was insulting the national anthem? I asked people to refuse to be slaves of the Communist Party. So do you think that I am disrespectful? Well, I cannot comment whether what you said was the national anthem. And if there is no intent to insult the national anthem, and if it is not the national anthem, of course, you have not committed the offense. Well, sometimes when we state the reality, we are not trying to disrespect the national anthem. But ever since 1949, most of the Chinese are like slaves. So I think the state itself is disrespecting itself. I won't think that I don't want to see white terror. Well, what I said just now was just stating the facts. And if you think that is not an offense, that is okay. Otherwise, the National Anthem Bill would become a white terror. Dr. Fernando Zhang, Chairman, what Dr. K.K. Kwok said is important. For Clause 7, you say that a person commits an offense if with intent to insult the national anthem, the person publicly and intentionally alters the lyrics or score of the national anthem. So for the lyrics, the first phrase is like this, "Arise, we who refuse to be slaves." It is very likely that this will be quoted in articles or in slogans. For example, if we are objecting to the Fugitive Offenders Ordinance, and if somebody writes this on a banner, "Arise, we who refuse to be slaves, let's object to the FOO." So would this be regarded as insulting the national anthem? Well, this is done publicly and intentionally. He deliberately quotes the national anthem to express his view. So for a behavior like this, would you regard it as having an intent to insult the national anthem? For what Dr. Zhang said is like what we've been telling you. For 7.1a, if the work itself includes the lyrics or score of the national anthem, then you have to look at Clause 8, that is whether it would lead to the reasonable belief that the piece of work is the national anthem or a part of the national anthem. And if it is so, then we would have to see whether you have the intent to insult the national anthem or whether it is done publicly and intentionally. These elements are all very clear. So for each scenario, we have to look at the actual situation before we can make a decision. But I would like to reiterate a point. In 1999, there was a Court of Final Appeal judgments. There was a principle. That is, if a restriction is imposed, it means that we cannot express our view in a way that the national anthem is insulted. It's not that you cannot express your views, but you cannot express your views by insulting the national anthem. So this is a safeguard. And it's not easy that you will be convicted. Now, but of course, what I said is done publicly and intentionally, and some people would think that this is part of the national anthem because it's actually a quote of the national anthem. He does not have the intent to insult the national anthem, but he uses the national anthem to express his views. Your time is up, Mr. Hui Chifeng. Let's talk about 7(2). Now here, if you do not set out clearly what the acts are, then this will be very dangerous. Now let me talk about my scenarios. Now, if at a major sports event, I do something publicly and intentionally and I insult the national anthem, well, I talk about it online, but I don't tell you what that act is. But when I actually go to the sports event, even if I cross my leg or if I go to the toilet, and you would think that this is an insulting behavior, this is quite ridiculous. So I think you have to be more reasonable. So can you change your way of drafting? Here you say that a person commits an offense if the person publicly intentionally insults intentionally anthem in any way. We don't want you to draft it like this in any way. So as long as I have said openly that I will insult the national anthem, then all my behaviors will be regarded as an insult to a national anthem? Okay, let me answer your questions. There are 3 points. Number one, as you said, Well, the scenario is like this. A person has publicly said that he has the intent to insult the national anthem. Then for his, well, he can have a lot of behaviors afterwards. Now, if you have the intent to insult the national anthem, and for bracket two, it says intentionally insults the national anthem in any way, then of course you will be caught. But the prosecutor would have to prove that you have the intent. So evidence must be adduced. And for the phrase in any way, I think you can find this in over 200 pieces of legislation. So this is not something unique.
So I think that's clear. So I want to make a suggestion, let's see if you will accept this. And that is, it will be doing something in the eye of an ordinary people that is conceived as something insulting. You haven't answered this question about Mr. Hui's suggestion. Under our legal system and in the judicial system, we already have a system to handle such cases. The onus of proof is on the prosecution, and the court would comply with the normal criminal standards. That is, the conviction is only allowed when there's reasonable benefit of doubt. Can you give us some examples of insulting the national anthem in any way? Mr. Hui, if you go to the website of the DOJ, you can find many examples. Well, give them some examples. Well, I'm not talking about in any way, but insults in any way. Insult, it may not be an offense under other laws. Mr. Kenneth Leung, 3 minutes. Chairman, a question about cross 7, bracket 2. The word in English is publicly.
If the person publicly and intentionally insults the national anthem,
and in some other laws, it's in public, not publicly. A person commits an offense if the person
national anthem in the public or in the public.
So there are two possibilities here. In other statutes, it's in the public rather than publicly. Is there a difference between the two? In many laws that would affect the public, there are different interpretations. Public sometimes includes a section of the public. If you are doing this in a private club, if you'd doing this to insult the national anthem with dozens of people in a private club, then you may have already committed an offense. So when you talk about publicly, are you talking about the number of people involved, or rather the objective environment involved? I'll ask Mr. Pang to respond. Thank you, Mr. Leung. Publicly is really about capable of public view, open to public view. There's something that happens to the public, in the public. What about my example? Something happens in a private club on an occasion where there are X that would
undermine
the dignity of the national anthem. Let's say it's bankrupt. Well, it has to be dependent on the fact that maybe it's a private club, but it's a closed the window, which, for example, Hong Kong club, no window, 40 people there. Well, don't drag me into this. I'm just talking about a private club. I'm not trying to involve you personally. It's just an analogy. A private club in a room, no window, 30 people there. Permanent secretary. Actually, we have answered this. I wanted to continue, but I wasn't given the chance. There is already precedent cases saying that a private premises can also be in public because it can be seen by the public. Chairman, at the council meeting of the 23rd of January, 7.5 was referred to that if this firm comment by media or is for purpose of giving instruction, then it will be accepted. But there's no explicit exception for this. But in part 3 of the copyright ordinance, a number of exceptions are explicitly provided. I'd asked a written question and I received a reply from the Bureau. And it says, if we provide a table, then there could be omissions. So my question is, why is this approach not adopted by the copyright ordinance? If using a table or tabulate the exceptions might lead to omissions, then is it that the approach adopted in the copyright ordinance is not good? Why can't we have a uniform approach? Are there any particular reasons why you want to adopt this special approach for the National Anthem Bill here? Let me try to answer this question. In the written reply, we refer to the Copyright Ordinance, which adopt this table approach. But in 7(5) in this bill, well, it's about publications in bracket 3 and bracket 4. It's openly, and there's an intent to insult the national anthem. And in bracket 5, we spell out that if something is not covered by subsection subclause 3 or 4, a person does not commit an offense by publishing the author lyrics or play or sing the national anthem in a distorted way. And we were talking about the media reports, showing some video clips, or in the course of giving instructions, such of clips are displayed. Such clips are shown, but there can be more scenarios that other than that. The important thing is that except as provided under subsections 3 and 4, no one will commit an offense under this section. This kind of formulation can cover a host of different scenarios. Any supplement? Next, Mr. Chan Chi Chin. Let me talk about a case. We have a Yong Hoi Lei, case of Yong Hoi Lei, who was given a custody term of 5 days administratively. He played a small section of the national anthem, and then followed by his singing. I would say that it's rather disrespectful. If a Hong Kong person does the same, and someone reports the case to the police, would this case be taken up? Well, you know that it's administrative custody, so there was no judgment for us to read. Can the officials tell us whether this is an offense? And if so, which provisions has he breached. And there's also a question about internet. Yes, they have guidelines on pornography, violence, or copyright. But if you talk about an intention to insult, the service provider will not make a judgment on a values issue. Let's say I find some clip on the YouTube. If this dispute is enacted, would you call YouTube that this is an insult to the national anthem? Please remove it, or make sure that Hong Kong people will not have access. It should be blocked to Hong Kong users. Are you saying that if the same kind of behavior happens in Hong Kong, would it be caught by Clause 7? I think it's a question about the intention. Chairman, you may see something on YouTube as suggested by Mr. Chan. In Hong Kong, after this bill is passed, we would enforce the law accordingly. So we have looked at the content of Clause 7. That's why I'm asking you this question. I'm just trying to say that it's difficult to give you an answer. But the factors to be considered are clear. The relevant factors are there. There's no context apart from seeing this on YouTube. But the problem is that we have a confirmed case, a precedent case on the mainland. Through you, Chairman, I would like to tell Mr. Chan that in Hong Kong, we have to enforce our law in accordance with our laws. So we should not compare our enforcement with the mainlands, because we have a different legal system. They are unwilling to answer my question. This is a most relevant question to ask. Mr. Wu Chi-wai, 2 minutes. I want to clarify this. In part two, there's the etiquette for playing and singing the national anthem, and then at Clause 7 is about insulting the national anthem. Or tomorrow I will attend a function which would play the national anthem, and a night before I openly said that I am going to insult the national anthem, and then when I attend the function, I stand solemnly, I behave, there's nothing wrong, apparently wrong with my behavior. But if I, because I announced that I would insult the national anthem the night before, would I be committing an offense? Or if apparently I followed, I comply with the etiquette, and there's no apparent disrespect, I would be okay? If you look at the factors in Clause 7, if the night before you openly said that you would insult the national anthem, this goes to show that you had the intention. But then you have to look at whether it's publicly, it's intentionally, it's the insulting the national anthem, and whether you have the necessary conduct and behavior. You have to do everything, every one of them. If you stand solemnly, you don't have any disrespectful behavior, caught by all these factors. Let's say I said I would insult the national anthem the previous night, and then when the national anthem is being played, I decide to go away. What would happen? Well, normally it would not be caught by the Clause 7. I said that there was the announcement of the intention to insult the national anthem, but he could have changed his mind later. the question is where that's the intention at the time of the act, not at the time when he made the announcement the previous night. Mr. Luk Chung Hong has left. He said he was pleased to note the certain things. I think I have to tell him the Legislative Council should look at the law, the bill from all sides, instead of deciding on what to do by the following instructions. I was talking about some acts that that people do before the enactment of the bill, say 4 or 5 years before the bill is passed. It's uploaded to the internet, whether it's Facebook or some other media. You have to you will say you would appeal to the person to do something, but no offense was committed, and you have been talking about. The Customs and Excise Department. Well, it was about infringement. It was an infringement at the time of the act. But I was talking about some act which is not against the law, which is not an offense. And it's not an offense even after the bill is enacted. So how can the police make an appeal for the video to be drawn, to be withdrawn? When I answer the question on a particular scenario, whether it's the police or the Customs and Excise Department, you will find out that there is something material that is being distributed, being published in the online the media, which is obviously an insult to the national anthem. Just like the Customs and Excise Department would ask for the matter to be withdrawn. If it's an infringement, we don't have to find out the person involved. Well, I was talking about an act which does not involve an offense, but you were talking about the commission of an offense at the time of your discovery. Would you ask him to reply? I think I have provided a very clear answer to that. Dr. K.K. Kwok, the third round, 2 minutes. Dr. Kwokake, thank you, Chairman. I want to make it clear. This offense may result in sending persecution and in the imprisonment of many innocent people. You talk about altering the lyrics or score of the national anthem. I will give you an example. Arise, we who refuse to be slaves to the CCP. It was not a part of a song. It's not sung. It's just something that people write. It's not played together with the score. Well, I'm just talking about writing out the words. And if that's a problem, well, it would be an offense committed by what you write. So you have a long queue of people waiting to be sent to Stanley Prison. So I want to make this clear. I'm not talking about playing and singing the lyric and the score together. Let's say I write an essay. Entitled Arise, We Who Refuse to Be Slaves of the Chinese Communist Party. They are the so-called red elements. We are not supposed to mention slaves. This works. Cannot be used. This is a monopoly of the Communist Party. Only they can use the word slaves. I would like Mr. Pang, the DOJ, the Deputy Law Judgment, to answer on top of the permanent secretary. I think the secretary has already answered this question. When we refer to some text and say that this is an offense, we have to look at clause 8. So that is someone who would reasonably regard this as part of the lyric or the and then it's an intentional insult. If it's just an expression of opinion instead of an intentional act to insult the national anthem, in other words, you're not singing or playing the lyric at the same time. It's just writing something out. It's not an offense. Well, it's not related to whether you have the score play and the lyrics sung. It's about the intention. Do you have the intention to insult the national anthem? If you just use the lyrics as a means to express your opinion, then of course 7 doesn't apply.
So when I'm going to write my article, I have to stipulate that I'm not insulting the national anthem, right? Okay. Ms. Claudia Mo. Okay, you request for the bell to be rung. Okay, we'll ring the bell. We now have a quorum. Now, earlier I've said that this is the second time that the division has been called. So if we do more of that again, I would suspect that some members are of the opinion that we don't have enough time to scrutinize this bill. Claudia Mo, 3 minutes. Thank you. Earlier, I asked the question and you stated clearly that the national anthem law, so long as it is not being used in a trademark or commercial investment, then other commercial behavior is acceptable. Say, on this cup, I printed the words, you know, that I print the lyrics of the march of the volunteers. You say that is all right, it's not an offense. But I find this rather strange. According to the National Anthem Law, I think this is also allowed. The National Anthem Law by itself allow for such commercial products which, can uses the national flag. And such, emblems could be printed onto commercial products. Now, the biggest difference here is that under the National Flag Ordinance, if one has to produce these commercial products using the National Flag of China, of the PRC, you have to apply. And after your application is approved, you can use it. Whereas under the National Anthem Law, if one uses the lyrics or the name of the anthem and the score and you print them onto the product itself, it's not an offense and you don't need to apply. Which means that any product we can actually print the National Anthem, including the name, the lyrics and the score onto the product itself, and one doesn't need to apply. So I find this rather odd. For what about other products like tablecloth or even underwear? Are you saying that it's not a problem? And thirdly, you always stress that one cannot publicly and intentionally insult the national anthem. Now, if I did this, that is putting the lyrics or the score of the national anthem and print them onto a cushion, and I do so publicly, would you say this is intentional? Of course it's intentional. I would only have the intention to sell the product if I do this. But would this be an insult? If you allow this to be done on a cushion in pajamas, you've asked the same question. No, I've asked the same question each and every time. I know exactly what is my question. This question has not been asked before, no. No, you did ask the same question in a different way. I said that no application is required. Could you answer the question as whether or not one needs to apply? No, the answer is no. Well, this is really, scary. Originally, you gave me the impression that the National Flag, Ordinance is stricter than the National Anthem Law. Okay, I'll go for the next round. Kwok Wai Kyung, 4 minutes. Thank you. I think I was asking for my right to speak during the last session because I heard Gary Fan, who made many wrong interpretations of the bill. First of all, Mr. Kwok, we are now scrutinizing Section 7. While we are on to Section 7, Mr. Fan had repeatedly stressed that this bill is mainly aiming at, promoting patriotism. But in the preamble, it is stated clearly that whether you support this or not, that's too late, Mr. Kwok, unless you want to come back to Clause 7. So what is meant by insult or being disrespectful? I'm sure any person who is well-educated will understand the meaning. Unfortunately, some colleagues are saying that they don't understand the meaning of insult or, actually undermining the dignity of the national anthem. I think in theory, all of us are well-educated and we are playing the very important role as counselors. How can we say that we don't know and we don't understand? At the same time, in order to store the passage of the bill, you are actually, they are actually, they keep saying that they don't understand the content of the bill. In fact, the relevant terminologies, whether in the law or in the public domain, there is already a common understanding or interpretation. So I don't think we need to argue over that excessively. James Toh, 4 minutes. Thank you. I don't think this is as simple as it seems. Mr. Kwok said that it's all very simple according to his own standard. So he said, are you, you know, pretending to be garbage? According to a standard, you know, calling somebody garbage is not in itself, but I think it is. Now, the national anthem is sung. So how do you insult, you know, something which is a sung? So I'll address this at different levels. Looking at the context of the bill, the target of the insult itself would be the national anthem. So I'll not rule out other things, so the public wouldn't need to worry. So when the national anthem is being played and a person is present, his son is, you know, actually not behaving properly, and the father scolded his son and told him to actually stand, you know, properly and slap in the face, that would not be an insult. At least there is no intention. I just want to clarify this. Now, if somebody calls me and I keep, you know, cursing at him over the phone, because he's my subordinate, I'm his boss, he has sold my property at a price lower than I stipulated, and I keep scolding that agent. I don't want the public to be so worried or be so afraid. Now, my third example is that, now, you say you are worried that the public may boo the national anthem. For example, you have the Hong Kong team, soccer team, you know, representing China, the national anthem is being played, and the soccer fans say, boo the Vietnamese, you know, national anthem, and boo the Vietnamese team. That shouldn't be an insult, right? So, let's say, so if the song itself is not constituting insult, what about an action? While the anthem is being played, I keep clapping my hands. Would that undermine the dignity of the national anthem? You say it would depend on the judgment of the police and whether the court accepts the evidence. And then a member said that you should know if you have received secondary education or a university education. That is difficult to understand. If your answer is that, you know, well, we leave it to the judge or the police to judge. So it's all very subjective. And then everybody would be afraid. If I agree that after you've, you know, passed this bill, now, if I say things like, you know, to hell with the national anthem, I would advise that you shouldn't say that, unless you want to engage in civil disobedience. But for scenarios which are not, you think are not, you know, an offense, I think you should at least let the public have the peace of mind so that they don't need to be unduly worried. Otherwise, when the national anthem is being played, people simply will not enter the venue. And you'll end up with very few people, you know, at the venue, because the people simply don't know how they should behave when the anthem is being played. Any response? Well, there are several questions here. First of all, in the entire national anthem bill, we've said many times that we're talking about respect for the national anthem. If you have no intention to insult the national anthem, you respect the national anthem, then you needn't worry. I don't think the majority of the public would be afraid. Mr. Junisol, sorry, it should be Outlaw Hin first. I can, you know, give the floor to Mr. Ho first. Mr. Outlaw Hin, it's your turn first. I'm asking this question on behalf of a friend. I heard the secretary and the PS, you know, referring to Section 8, and there's a lot of talk about the Song Football Carnival. In responding to a question raised by a colleague and also the connection with Section 8, you're saying that even a part of the song resembles a national anthem, but if you listen to the entire song, you wouldn't say that it's a national anthem, and therefore, according to Section 8, you will not regard that as a national anthem. So in other words, to judge whether or not a piece of music is considered to be a national anthem based on Section 8, you will look at the you will consider the entire song. Right now, let's say if you have a 10-minute long song, and for 30 consecutive minutes, the main theme of the national anthem is being played, and during those 30 seconds, there's no amendment to the national anthem.
According to the secretary, because most of the melodies does not resemble the national anthem, then on the whole, it would not be regarded as a national anthem. So, is my understanding correct? That is, you have to look at the whole song as a whole, and you don't just look at parts of the song, for example, 30 consecutive seconds, and 90% of this 30 seconds resemble the national anthem. I have answered this question already. We can look at it from two perspectives. First, if it's the whole national anthem and then you alter the lyrics or score, then we will look at the intent, that is whether there's an intent to insult. And if it is a new creation and part of it contains the lyrics or resembles the score of the national anthem, then we will look at the whole of the piece and see whether people will think that this is the national anthem. Now, the Football Chronicle is a very good example because a section of it is actually the national anthem itself. So if you alter the lyrics, of course, that is one thing. But if you play a part of the national anthem, how would you view it? And if a person alters the lyrics or score of the national anthem, and if it is in a longer article, then that part would not be regarded as the national anthem. So how do you define such alteration? Now, you can refer to Clause 8, that is, it would lead to the reasonable belief that a piece of music is the national anthem or part of the national anthem. I think the government has to explain to us about the Football Chronicles. Now, there is a song, and a part of it resembles the national anthem closely. And if you just, you're just looking at part of the song, then you may invoke Clause 8. I have answered this question already. I can answer it again. Now, for the Football Chronicles, it is a song. And on the whole, do you think that song would lead people to think that it's a national anthem? You should view it this way. Mr. Junius Ho, I would like to ask Mr. Lawrence Pang about Clause 7, Bracket 5. For bracket 5 is the opposite of 3 and 4. For 3, a person commits an offence if with intent to insult the national anthem, the person intentionally publishes altered lyrics or an altered score of the national anthem, or the national anthem played and sung in a distorted or disrespectful way.
And for a person commits an offence, if with intent to insult the national anthem, the person intentionally publishes the insulting in any way of the national anthem. So these are two offences. And for subclause 5, except as provided under subsection 3 or 4, a person does not commit an offence under this section by publishing ABC, then, well, ABC would not be regarded as offences. So the most important thing is whether you have the intent. Even if you publish some materials, and if you have the intent to insult the national anthem, to disrespect the national anthem, then you have committed an offence. So for 7(5), to me, is superfluous. Well, a person, if he has done 7(3) and 7(4), then he has committed an offence. So you do not need 7(5). I think 7(5) only makes the provision more ambiguous. So as long as it's not 7(3), or you're not caught under 7(3) or 4, that would be okay. Will you consider deleting 7(5)? Thank you for your question. Yes, you are correct. For subclause 3, it's about an act, is publish. And there's an element of with intent to insult, and it's divided into A and B. There are two different acts, that is altered lyrics or an altered score of the national anthem, or the national anthem played and sung in distorted or respectful way. And for subclause 4, there is an act, and there is an element of intent. So the contents of the act is to insult the national anthem in any way. And for 5, except as provided in subsection 3 or 4, a person does not commit an offence under this section by publishing the following three things. So for subclause 5, we want to clarify a point, that is, other than subsection 3 or 4, the person will not at the same time be caught by subclause 2, because subclause 2 states that a person commits an offence if the person publicly and intentionally insults the national anthem in any way. And for subclause 5, if it's not caught by subsection 3 or 4, he would not be caught by subclause 2 because of this. So he may be guilty of subclauses 3 and 4. If not, he would not be caught by subclause 2. So we need subclause 5, right? Okay, thank you. Mr. James Toh, I would ask the government official to answer your earlier question. For Mr. Toh's question, first, as I said just now, the bill itself is about respect and about publicly and intentionally insulting the national anthem, so you won't be caught easily. And for the word insult, its object is the national anthem. So in the bill, and in the previous parts, we have been talking about etiquettes. They are in they are guidelines, and they do not carry with them penalties. But under clause 7, these are offences, and there are penalties. The prosecutor would have to bear the burden of proof. So these are the principles, and I hope that the elements are clear. It's very easy to look at your examples by using these principles. Just now you said that on an occasion when the national anthem is played, and then you scold the child, and that would not be regarded as insulting the national anthem. Okay, so that's not insulting the national anthem. How about that I swear at the other team, I am a supporter of team A, and I shout that team B will definitely lose. So we have to look at whether you have the intent to insult the national anthem. Okay, so that's not insulting the national anthem. So how about question number 3? That is, a person is talking on the telephone, and he's using foul language. So you also have to establish that he has the intent to insult the national anthem, and he does it publicly and intentionally. You have to look at the whole scenarios. So he's talking on the phone. There's another side on the phone, and he is actually swearing at the other party, right? So you have to establish the intent. Yes, thank you for your answer. You have to understand this. Well, we're talking about sound, and then you say that the people have to stand solemnly, etc. And here you mention insult. So if you do not explain to us, then people don't know how to interpret it. And the Secretary for Security said that if you are doing business properly, you won't be afraid of extradition. So you can tell people that if you don't insult the national anthem, then there will be no problem. Mr. Gary Fang, I would like to ask about 7-2. Just now, the Secretary asked Mr. Pang to answer the question. I think that for 7-2, its present way of drafting is problematic because it casts a net wider than altering the lyrics or score. Now, if you draft it like this, and if you are not just copying from PLC's national anthem law, then I still don't understand why you write it this way. Can you explain to me with a concrete example? Now, in the English version, you use the phrase in any way. I think this is too wide a scope. People don't want to be caught so easily. So can you cite an example? Can you tell us under what circumstances would people be caught? And if you don't write it this way, then the law cannot be enforced. If you use the PLC's way of drafting the law, you cannot achieve the effect in Hong Kong. Well, you always tell us that we will have to rely on the court. But this is about a legislative intent. I think the DOJ would have to think very carefully about drafting and about the definition of behaviors. This have to be very clear in the law. You can't tell us that this will be decided by the court. Well, he has the right to answer you in a way he likes. I think Mr. Pang has answered you, but I'll answer you once again. For 7-2, well, insult the national anthem in any way. I can cite an example. When a national anthem is played, and if you have the intent to insult the national anthem, that means you boo the national anthem. Now, press the button again. Next, Mr. Charles Mock. 2 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. For clause 7 and subclauses 3 and 4, yes, you may say that you are focusing on the intent. And for subclause 5, as except as provided under subsection 3 or 4, a person does not commit an offense under the section by publishing the following three things. So for subclause 5, now if there's an internet service provider or an intermediary, he won't be liable under subclause 5, right? Because normally he wouldn't have the intent. Now, if the service provider or the intermediary transmits the materials, he does not have the intent to insult the national anthem, or he may not even know that there are insulting elements, so of course it's not liable. So if a person shares a hyperlink or he shares on his social media, this questionable clip, what will you do? You have to look at the offense elements. Now, for the one that shares the materials, if he does not have the intent to insult the national anthem when he shares the contents, then he has not committed an offense. So you have to prove that he has the intent, right? So when it happened, he may not know that the creator of the materials intent, right? So you really have to prove that he has the intent. But what if it's just a hyperlink? Sorry, Chairman, I want to finish my question. Now, for a hyperlink, it's just a series of letters. So when you handle things like this, are there differences? I remember when we scrutinized the copyright bill, they say that hyperlink is excluded. Now, for the message, no matter whether it's a hyperlink or not, the prosecutor would have to prove without reasonable doubts that he has the intent. So even if he shares a hyperlink, he may be liable, right? Otherwise, you won't have to look at the intent. Your time is up. Mr. Olokhin. Anyone who publicly and intentionally alters the lyrics or score of the national anthem, he commits an offense. So no matter how you alter the lyrics or score, it would be regarded as alteration. What is the difference between alteration and change? Does it mean that, well, if he distorts the national anthem, that is alteration? Well, for alteration, we have a look at Article 15 of the mainland law, and this means that originally there's something established, but now I change it, and that means I alter it. So for this alteration, in terms of law, is there retrospective effect? Well, for the whole piece of legislation, it has no retrospective effect. Have you heard a Cantonese version of March of the Volunteers, which is called Fan Hei Tou Kang? In 1935, the March of the Volunteers was composed, and in 1939, Pang Bao Yip, Wong Pui Ying created the Cantonese version, and they had new lyrics. And these are the Cantonese lyrics, and according to the government, well, of course, those people were not liable because there's no retrospective effect. But what if a person sings this Cantonese version in the future, and because the lyrics have been altered? Well, the subject matter itself, we will try to find out whether it's caught by this piece of legislation. Well, what if the lyrics are totally different? So it's like what the secretary said, would ordinary people have a reasonable belief that this is the national anthem? So this Cantonese version cannot be heard. here anymore, right? Is this correct, Secretary? So this is not only about clause 8. We also have to look at the intent, whether that person has an intent to insult the national anthem. I suggest that we take a small break for 5 minutes now. The next speaker would be Dr. Eleanor Wong.